The psalmist writes, I lift my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth, who forgives my sins and heals my diseases. These certainly are strange times we're living through, in even on such a Sunday as this, as we don't get to meet together. But it's in this time that we get to choose to look to the Lord, look to our Lord Jesus, who himself said, in this world you will have trouble, but take heart, for I have overcome the world. As we begin this morning, would you pray with me? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are here. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your faithfulness, and we thank you for the invitation you have given us to come to gather together in your name and to worship you. In this time, we ask that you would give us eyes to see and ears to hear what you would say to us. And we pray that everything that is said and done here would bring honor and glory to you and to you alone. It's in your name we pray these things. And everyone said, amen. Let's sing together this morning as we remember our God who is unchanging. Our God, firm foundation, our rock, the only solid ground. As nations rise and fall, kingdoms once strong, now shaken, we trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. All your wisdom, in love and justice you will reign, and every knee will bow. We bring our expectations, our hope is anchored in your name, in the name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. Our banner high, we lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign, your kingdom has no end. We lift our banner high, we lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign, your kingdom has no end. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. forevermore. You are victorious.
Amen. Today is Palm Sunday, a day in the Christian year that we remember Jesus's triumphal entry into Jerusalem on the week before the events of his death. This morning, we're going to sing and we're going to read the story of that event together. But for just a moment, I need to adjust something with the technology here. Thank you for bearing with me. I would like to read this story together with you, but the confidence monitor here turned off, so I couldn't read that. So as you see the words here on the screen, let's read the story together. As Jesus and the disciples approached Jerusalem, they came to the town of Bethphage on the Mount of Olives. Jesus sent two of them on ahead. "Go into the village over there," he said. "As soon as you enter it, you will see a donkey tied there with its colt beside it. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone asks what you are doing, just say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will immediately let you take them." This took place to fulfill the prophecy that said, "Tell the people of Jerusalem, 'Look, your king is coming to you. He is humble, riding on a donkey's colt. The two disciples did as Jesus commanded. Must have gotten out of order. Sorry, one more moment as we try and fix this. Again, guys, thank you for your patience. We are doing our best with just Pastor Jerry and I here. All right, let's try that again. As Jesus and the disciples approached Jerusalem, they came to the town of Bethphage on the Mount of Olives. Jesus sent two of them on ahead. "Go into the village over there," he said. "As soon as you enter it, you will see a donkey tied there with its colt beside it. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone asks you what you are doing, just say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will immediately let you take them." This took place to fulfill the prophecy that said, "Tell the people of Jerusalem, 'Look, Your king is coming to you. He's humble, riding on a donkey, riding on a donkey's colt. The two disciples did as Jesus commanded. They brought the donkey and the colt to him and threw their garments over the colt, and he sat on it. Most of the crowd spread their garments on the road ahead of him, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Jesus was in the center of the procession, and the people all around him were shouting, "Praise God for the Son of David. Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God in the highest heavens." The entire city of Jerusalem was in an uproar as he entered. "Who is this?" they asked. And the crowds replied, "It's Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth." Let's sing and remember that story.
Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way. Welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hosanna, loud Hosanna, the little children sing. Through pillared court and temple, the lovely anthem rang to Jesus, who had welcomed them and spoke of them as blessed. The children sing their praises, the simplest and the best. And from all of it they followed a happy, joyous crowd, their large palm branches waving and singing. Little girl and boy, Hosanna in the highest, that ancient song we sing, for Christ is our Redeemer, the Lord of heaven, our King. Oh, may we ever praise him with heart. Holy presence, eternally rejoice. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. How you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. And if this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. All your ways are good. All your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone, higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone, in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I love. And how you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. Light into the world, light into my life. I will live for you alone. You're the one I seek, knowing I will find all I need in you alone, in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. And if this life I lose, I will follow you. Life everlasting in you. There's freedom for my soul in you. There's joy, unending joy. And I will follow where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. Serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. Oh, I will follow you. I will follow you.
Special moment when we gather our hearts and our minds together in prayer. I know some of you are sitting around a table today or maybe in your comfortable chair. It doesn't really matter what the date on the calendar is when it comes to worshiping the Savior. What really matters is where our heart is at this moment. Is our heart trusting? Is our heart serving? Is our heart following? Are we obedient? If we would answer no to any of those questions, then this is the moment to change that. This is the moment when we remind ourselves of all that's important. When we remind ourselves that the heroes we used to have are not the heroes we have today. The heroes we have today are those frontline workers. The nurses, the doctors, the paramedics, the police who go to the domestic disturbance calls. It's in those moments when we watch and we see their devotion to duty that we're reminded of our devotion to duty, our devotion in worship and in praise, our faithfulness to the Father. So this day as we pray, let's remember to pray for those whose lives are more than disrupted. Maybe their lives hang by a single thread. Maybe their lives are spent in long, weary hours caring for others. Would you raise them up? Would you bless them and their families who suffer while they're alone? So this morning, God, as we worship you, our hearts are filled with praise, with joy, with expectation, mostly with thanksgiving. Thanksgiving that you have called us. You have forgiven us before we even knew you existed. You have prepared a place for us. You have prepared a call upon our lives. And now this morning, Father, you extend your enablement, your hand of strength into the hearts and lives of those who serve in delicate areas, those who put themselves in harm's way for the good of their fellow man, for those who have accepted the call to go around the world, to go down the street, to go to the neighbor. For each one who listens or watches this day, Father, would you join them together in the bond of love as one family, as one mind and one heart, and that heart bleeds to be obedient, to know you in your fullness, to know the power of your great presence, to realize how blessed a people we really are. Thank you for the gift of technology, even though sometimes we think it's possessed. Thank you, Father, for the fact that you have provided people to train some of us, or to try to, that we have this media exposure where we can be distant from each other but still be together in these moments. Thank you, Father, for those who serve, who spend themselves in giving and in love, who sacrifice. For each of these, Father, we pray you would strengthen and encourage them. And for this day, Lord, this Palm Sunday in 2020, we give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to draw your attention to the fact this is Holy Week, first day of the first day of this season that we refer to as Holy Week, when we recognize a triumphal entry into the city of Jerusalem in an unexpected manner on a donkey colt rather than a charging white stallion that symbolized triumph and greatness and majesty. We think of the courage of Christ, knowing what this week would hold, knowing what was in the minds of the people. He goes ahead. He moves further, farther than those around him. He sees the end of the week, not just the beginning. He sees the culmination of a ministry, not just a moment on Sunday morning. For Jesus, this had a different impact. For Jesus, this was an obedience to the Father. It's him laying down his life. For the disciples, they had grandiose plans and ideas. The crowd had an agenda all their own. And there was Christ in the midst of a crowd, alone, struggling with thoughts of how the week would end. Would he be faithful? Would he be able to bear up under it? He knew exactly how this week would unfold, and he went to the cross anyway. So I want us to think about a critical element this week, not the beginning of the week only, but mostly about the end of the week. How does this week end? When we look at the book of Matthew chapter 27, I want to go back to verse 46 and 41 and start there. Verse 41, in the same way the chief priests The teachers of the law and the elders mocked him. He saved others, they said, but he can't save himself. He's the king of Israel. Let him come down from the cross, and we'll believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him. For he said, I'm the Son of God. And then in verse 46, about 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? It's a little early for a Father's Day gift, maybe, but you have time to order it on Amazon. I want to give you the title of a book written by Pat Williams. The name of the book is Character Carved in Stone. Character Carved in Stone by Pat Williams. It's various chapters about different people. The second chapter is the story of Lieutenant Alexander Ramsey Neininger Jr. He was better known to his friends as Sandy. It was said by the men he served with that Sandy always went where the fighting was the fiercest. On that January 12th day in 1942, Japanese troops broke through the perimeter around the American soldiers. Now, some soldiers panicked and ran from the enemy. Sandy ran toward the enemy, shot a sniper out of a tree, took a bullet in his leg, bandaged it himself, got up and kept on going. In a hailstorm of fire all around him, he moved toward enemy foxholes, silencing one gun nest after another. Inspired by their lieutenant's courage, the entire company followed him into battle. Moving still further ahead, Sandy, now having run out of ammunition, did you hear me? Ran out of ammunition, continued using only his bayonet. His comrades saw Sandy take a second bullet, this time in the upper body. Bandaged by a medic in a shell crater, he left the medic there while he continued moving forward still, where he took another bullet, this time in the shoulder. Without stopping, he dropped 3 more enemy soldiers with only his bayonet. Now spent from exhaustion and loss of blood, Sandy falls mortally wounded. Douglas MacArthur, writing about Sandy Neininger, said, he single-handedly changed the course of the war in the Philippines. General Douglas MacArthur goes on to write these words, a true leader has the confidence to stand alone, the courage to make tough decisions, and the compassion to listen to the needs of others. So why would we go this direction on a beautiful, sunny Palm Sunday morning? Because instead of wishing our lives were problem-free, we should probably be thanking God that he finds us worthy to be his agents in healing, his agents in helping others in an uncertain time, in an uncertain world. So, to encourage us to be willing to risk everything if necessary, to throw ourselves into the engagement, to spend our lives in a worthy endeavor for the sake and the cause of Christ Jesus. And when we do, we find that faith replaces fear with courage. We've just read in verse 46 the largest, most misinterpreted passage in Scripture. It has Jesus questioning why his heavenly Father has deserted him in his hour of need. Now, taken at face value, it's very hard for us to listen to those words, to put ourselves in the place of Christ, trying to imagine the pain and anguish he was experiencing. There we go. Two mistaken views. The first is the result. They said he feels he's forsaken because he has shouldered the sins of the world, and somehow that has, along with the pain, has discouraged him and disheartened him. The second reason they said he felt forsaken was that God had turned away, unable to look at his only son. So why would we have a problem with that mistaken view? Because, first of all, it appears God is unfaithful in keeping his promises. Here's the mob in the crowd. The disciples also agonize over the lack of Jesus being delivered. Their greatest question is, where is God in all of this? Was Jesus mistaken? Was he not the Messiah? Is he not the Son of God? And if he is, where is God? How does he let such a tragedy happen? Well, they must have forgotten this verse in Joshua 1:5, where God says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And in verse 9, well, it's jumping ahead there. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Is there any part of that verse that would have excluded Christ going to the cross? Certainly not. Wherever you go, I will be with you. So, that verse cannot mean Christ truly felt forsaken. And it also raises serious questions about Jesus' acceptance of the cross in his Father's plans. Did Christ not know there was going to be a cross? Did Christ not realize he was going to die in all of this? It sounds as though he is questioning his Father's faithfulness when no deliverance appears. The answer to these questions really is found in the 22nd Psalm. It goes back to a prophecy that King David had about this future moment in time. It begins with a cry of desolation, the very same words that Christ speaks of there in Matthew 27, verse 46. And in that verse, he is not really announcing to the world he feels forsaken. Instead, he is quoting a verse, verse 1 from the 22nd Psalm. It is an expression of faith, not of fear. Because that psalm is not a lament alone. It begins as a lament, but it goes to praise and it goes to rejoicing, and it mentions the faithfulness of God while all of those other feelings are coupled together. Now remember, Jesus is suffocating while he hangs on the cross. He has to raise himself up to take a breath into his lungs as he hangs there by his hands. He has to straighten his legs, lift himself up, which is probably a very good reason why he doesn't repeat from memory all 30-some verses in that psalm. He only repeats the first verse, the verse by which they would recognize exactly what he's referring to. So if you go to the 22nd Psalm, Jesus is sending them a reminder. He's sending them a message about the faithfulness of God, not the feelings of being forsaken by him. Remember Jesus' words here at the end of his life. He mentions, it is finished. Now, it refers to the Father's plan and purpose. So Jesus knows exactly what that is, and he knows that his death is the fulfillment of the Father's plan. He knows that Christ, that the Father will not deliver him from dying. He knows he is to give himself unto death for the salvation of mankind. He knows that's the reason for his coming. So Mark 10:45, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. It just reminds us exactly what his purpose is, and he knows what that is. He knows he's not going to be delivered. Now, he settled that question, if you remember, in the Garden of Gethsemane. He settled the question that he did not have to survive. He only had to be obedient. Now, what he's praying about that day in particular, I believe, is not just that the cup of suffering would be removed from him if it was possible, but also that he might bear up under the persecution, the pain, the agony, and death itself, and be faithful to all that God was asking of him. The key is not that he would be spared from suffering. He's not praying about the removal of pain and death, but that he would be triumphant through his suffering and pain. That's a great prayer, by the way. It acknowledges we all suffer. It acknowledges we're human, we're frail, and we need a Father who bears us up. Not the verbal encouragement alone, such as, I am with you always, do not be afraid, but the one whose power is able to enable us to live above the discouragement. So go to Psalm 22 if you haven't already. It's progressive. If you look at the whole psalm, you see what begins as a sad, we'll say whiny discourse in the midst of suffering becomes rejoicing and trusting. Now, in verse 4, the psalmist writes, in you, our ancestors put their trust. They trusted you and you delivered them. So very early on in this psalm, he is moving into that phase of rejoicing that God can be trusted. And then he said in verse 5, to you they cried out and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. Then back to verse 6, which is a continued complaint. But in verse 7, you are enthroned. Our faith has been justified, is what he's speaking of. And then in verse 7, all who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord, they say. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. Those verses are the exact thing that's going on, which Christ himself, as he hangs on the cross, is literally feeling and hearing the crowd and the mob, or even the disciples, repeat and question God. It's the normal element in the midst of suffering, the humanness of who we are. Now in verse 16, we go back to the prophet Isaiah in what is called the suffering servant passage. Verse 16, dogs surround me, a pack of villains encircles me. They pierce my hands and my feet. All my bones are on display. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment. This is from Isaiah 53, verse 5. He was pierced for our transgressions, carried out in John 19:34, where the soldier pierces the side of Christ. It's as though the Romans had read this and were playing out a drama But it's the opposite. It's a prophecy of what was reality. And then in Luke 23, 35, we have what we read in verse 17. All my bones are on display. People stare and gloat. There we go. And in verse 18, the passage where they divide clothes and cast lots. In John 19, 34, 24, they said, let's not tear his cloak. Let's decide by lot who will get it. Again, the drama is continually portrayed. Then in verses 21 through 23, there is a praise that's happening. I will declare your name to my people in the assembly. I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel. For, verse 24, he has not hidden his face from him, but he has listened to his cry for help. So exactly where we pick up that verse in Matthew 27, 46 is the Psalm 22, verse 1. So instead of disappointment and discouragement, we read that expression of praise about the Father's faithfulness. The trust and confidence that Christ feels as he gives them verse chapter 22, verse 1. The reminder of the Father's faithfulness. That what is happening now is temporary. God is involved in it. He knows it. He hears my cry for help. He does not deliver me, but he hears my prayer. The Apostle Paul enters this passage. We missed that one. Last one. In Hebrews 5, 7 to 9, during the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard, Paul writes, because of his reverent submission. So God did not turn his face away. God did not tune out his cries and tears, but he did not deliver him either. That morning on Mount Moriah, when Abraham raises the knife and is going to plunge it into the heart of his son Isaac with the full intention of ending his life, God sends an angel, and the angel says, stop, Abraham, don't you touch him. In that moment, God the Father and his Son, Jesus Christ, are walking in heaven, and they're watching that scene played out below them. And the Son says to the Father, on that day when the Roman soldier raises his spear to pierce my side, will you say, stop, don't touch him? And God the Father says, no, because we never ask them to do in symbol what we aren't willing to do in reality. So Jesus on the cross understands the Father's plan. He's not discouraged because the Father does not deliver him, for he knows the Father's plan and his purpose. And he knows that that purpose is fulfilled, or it is finished, when he breathes his last breath. What is it? The Father's plan for your and my salvation. So when the disciples ask that day, as they see Christ hanging on the cross, where is God? God was preparing for Easter, for the empty tomb. He was preparing for the salvation of all mankind from the power and the captivating presence of sin. He was preparing a wonderful salvation. The Father's purpose is not to deliver him from suffering, but to enable him to be faithful and triumphant through suffering. So I ask this morning, should God, who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for the redemption of mankind, spare you and I from trouble in this life? Well, the answer is a given. The answer is no. He did not spare his own son. He does not spare us. He does not spare us from the pain. He does not spare us from the persecution. He does not deliver us from tragedy. He does enable us to be triumphant through it, in spite of it. Because you've heard me say many times, God is more burdened with building character in us than he is in making us comfortable. So instead of wishing our lives were problem-free, we should be thanking God that he finds us worthy to be his agents of healing, his agents of encouragement, his agents of grace and mercy in an uncertain time, in an uncertain world. So we must be willing to risk everything, to throw ourselves into the battle as Sandy did, to spend our lives in a worthy cause for the sake of Christ, with the promise that when we do, that faith will replace fear with courage. Father, thank you for the wonderful promise that you will never leave us or forsake us. Thank you also that in uncertain times, we recognize or do not recognize your hand in all things. But we believe and have learned that you can be trusted. So this day, would you minister to each one of us as we throw ourselves into the fray, into the battle called life, to be encouragements, to be ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ, to spend ourselves in a worthy cause for your sake, for your glory, for your honor. Thank you, Father, that you have called us out of the world, the church. Not the church because we gather in a building, but the church because we are the called out ones of God. Bless each one this day as they minister where they are, and serve wherever they will be found faithful. In your name we pray. Amen.
Spirit, we long to embrace.
hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. Always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. And almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness, you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Let's sing that one more time. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. Our hearts always hunger. Always hunger for.
Would you pray with me before we go? Lord God, as we go out from this place, remind us of your presence and of your faithfulness to keep the promises that you've made to us. And in reminding us that you're with us, give us courage to bear through the suffering that we may be experiencing. Give us the heart to bear through suffering that other people may be facing. Help us know how to love and serve others in this time. We ask this in the name above all names, in the name of Jesus Christ. Said together, amen. Thank you. You are dismissed.